So it's my pleasure to introduce Nicola Pera, who's in the same office suite as mine and is a research professor, or shortly to be a research professor at Northeastern University, physicist by training and by profession or by research, leading scholar in human dynamics, in particular in the context of complex human systems. So. Nicola.
Can you hear me, by the way? Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, it's very exciting to be here. Okay, today I will speak about we present a general framework to map and rank scientific production and consumption. So let's dissect the title, what I mean by mapping. So this is a prototypical paper. Today we saw a lot of this example, and there are many information you can extract from it. The journal of publication, of course the volume and the number of publication, then the day and the year of publication. The authors and the titles. And as we saw today, the large majority of research done in this field focus either on the journal level, on the author level. But there is a lot of other type of information you can extract from such type of papers. That is actually the geographical information. And this is what we did. This is what we mean by mapping. We take all the papers of a publication database and we map them. And we map them at different geographical resolutions. For example, this paper, although it's not explicitly written there, but you can assume to get this information, is written in US. Then in US we have states, so New Jersey, Princeton as a city, and then you can actually drill down to the laboratory and the actual affiliation of the authors. So what do we mean instead by production and consumption? So the large majority of papers, except some paper of Fermi probably, didn't have a lot of citation. For example, these two other influential papers. And how can interpret the citation? So these are very big general question, but I mean, is reasonable to think that in order to write this amazing and, by the way, Nobel Prize winning paper, Gross and Wilczek had to import some knowledge in terms of mathematical formalism, other results, or some mathematical trick from, for example, Weinberg and Gell-Mann. So that actually export information back to them. So we can actually use, and it's not just it actually helps us to characterize the system, to use an economical analogy. And actually we can consider citation as a goods, as a currency that actually traded between parties. So we can consider, for example, that Gross and Wilczek actually, what they did is to basically invest, create some depth and get basically borrow some unit of knowledge from Weinberg and Gell-Mann. They actually developed some credit. So, for example, these are actually the results of their investment. Here are all the cities that actually cite Gross and Wilczek back. And as you see, the little ball moving is the centroid of the thing that actually tells you where is the most number of citations are coming from. And you see actually it was a pretty good investment. Well, most of the cities where there is a physics department cite this amazing paper. So, as usual, in this field, it's natural to represent the system as a network. So there are many different granularities you can consider. There is the country, there is a city, the institution, and in each one of those, we consider a network in which each node is these geographical entities, so a country, a city, an institution, and the citation between them at that level are actually the links between them. And using the economical analogy that I just present you help us to define and in a way characterize and classify the nodes in two types. There are the producers, that are the nodes that the city, institution, or countries, they actually are export more knowledge they import. So basically, in terms of citation, they are cited more than they cite. So actually, they produce net some knowledge. Instead, the consumer, vice versa, are nodes that actually, country, institution, or city, they actually import more knowledge than they export. So the question now is, how can we characterize this system? So we have a lot of, we have a different layer, different type of networks. How can we characterize the complex set of relationship between producer and consumers, going beyond the simple local perspective? because you can imagine there is a lot, a big system and a lot of imbalance. So in other words, if a bit of knowledge is produced in I, where everything considered is finally consumed. In order to do this, we present this algorithm that we call knowledge diffusion proxy, and is a physical term, a bias random walk with sources that are the producer and the sinks that are the consumer. And it's very simple. You introduce a unit of knowledge in a producer, you let diffuse in following the weight in a bias random walk, and whenever the knowledge, the bit of knowledge find a consumer, it might be absorbed. And then you can repeat this game many, many, many times for each producer, for all the producer, and then characterize what is basically the complex and hidden, in a way, web of knowledge between producers and consumers. And actually, this is a generalization of this measure produced by Serrano, Bugugnev, and Spignani for economical networks, the so-called dollar experiment. So what do we mean by ranking? So this conference is about this, how we can measure the importance of nodes. We saw, and Santo today killed H-index, and so we know that there's a lot of problems with this measure, number of citation, H-index, I mean, we can do much better than that. So what we can do? This is intuition. Not all the citation have the same importance. Citation, they come from big institutions, for example, big researchers, might be more important than others. So, and actually, this is the same thing that Google does when they map the importance of pages. And in terms of collaboration networks, at the author level, this is what, for example, Santo and collaborators did in the physics author ranking algorithm. We extend this thing for our purpose, and we propose a scientific production ranking algorithm that is work as the Google PageRank. It's a simple diffusion process. Each node in the beginning and some level of the same level of credit. The credit diffuses in the network as a diffusion process. And then at the final stage, in the stationary states, you basically, for each node, you have the importance of each node. So this is the quotation slide. So what I mean by scientific, actually, is physics. Of course, there is much more than physics in science, although Rutherford will not be happy about this. But we know that there is much more than that. So there is something that is much bigger than physics, and actually we know that network science, actually, is much bigger than physics. So I'm using network science theory, mapping physics, so I figured that scientific is a proper word. Anyway, joking aside, I'm considering the American Physical Society database, and it's quite small respect to the ISI Web of Knowledge, but still good. There are 500,000 papers. We saw before there are 1,000,000 affiliation strings that go from 1893 to 2009, and there are almost 5,000,000 citations. This is an important thing. If you consider a map, the knowledge, I mean, all the papers at the country level, you have that 43%, everything considered, is produced in US. But if you consider year by year, for example, 10 years, the 86% was produced in US. So we're very, very much localized. And actually, if you notice, Weinberg, Gell-Mann, all these big guys, they didn't even have a bother to put US in the affiliation because it was American Physical Society, I mean, it's US. But instead, nowadays, the last 10 years, just 37% of papers is actually published in US, and actually similar to what we observe in other databases. This is the link of the, but I figure that here probably you already know this database anyway. So what we did, we have many different granularities that we can focus on. We study the city level. So we mapped more than 2,000 cities, and it's not an easy task, of course. A few words about it. One possible approach is this. You go to ask to your search engine. There are many different APIs. There is Google, there is the Bing, and the Yahoo. But of course, when you have papers written in the 80s, or even before that, is a very complicated thing to do because there are cities that don't exist anymore, countries that disappear, countries that emerge, so, and it's difficult to judge what is the actual accuracy of these things. So we use a different approach. We use some heuristic, some natural language processing, and a hierarchical approach in which basically we first map country, then the state, if in US, and then city. And with this approach, we map 97% of the papers, so quite good, with an accuracy of more than 98%, of occurrence. This is a very, very brief representation of the data. Each 5 years, each dot is a city. The size of the dot is proportional to how many papers were written. And you see the usual suspect, west and east coast, and a bit of in the middle. So the results. This is the network representation. Actually, is the backbone, so the most statistically important links of the network. Each node, again, is a city, and the links between them are the citation. You see that in the 60s, not just in Europe was not much going on, but also in US. Most of the publications were between East and West Coast. And as the time goes by, you see that the level of complexity of the system actually increased, as we can imagine. So what about producers and consumers? So red producers, let's say good, blue consumers that are, let's say, bad, or going to be producer in a way. In the 1990s, most of the consumers in the US were East and West Coast, and some of North Europe. And in 2009, you see instead that there is an explosion of consumer in US, as well as in Italy and France and Germany, all the Europe, and actually Japan as well. You can actually zoom in and go state by state, for example, in US, and see what happened. You see actually that this is clear now, this tendency in which basically the large majority of cities are now actually consumer. And you see, for example, Italy was mostly a consumer and now become a producer, actually, in 2009. So what about the knowledge diffusion process? Again, I put a bit of knowledge in a producer, and I focus on the spreading. I see where it finally ends. And for the top producer in US, you see, I'm ranking the top 10 consumer, where the final unit of knowledge is actually absorbed. And it's interestingly, Beijing is the first consumer. So it means that the large majority of unit of knowledge that we put in each of these producer finally ends up in Beijing. And actually, you can see actually the trend. It peaks in 2000. Actually, nowadays, in 2007, Beijing was not a consumer anymore. It was actually a producer, and now it's kind of battling between the two things. And one can argue that is due to the big investment that they did, for example, in the 1990s and 2000. And the same picture happened if you consider the top producer in Europe. For example, Beijing, again, is there. Okay, what about the ranks? This is the big picture. So this is what we found. From the 1990s to 2009, each 5 years, the top 20, you see that Boston is good, is the first, so good. With Boston, we mean also Cambridge. We mix them together. And so this is Boston actually was second in 1990s, now it's actually the first for more than 20 years. And then you see that, for example, other how can I do that? Yes, you see, for example, another city like Palo Alto. Palo Alto was very good in the top 10, then goes down, a bit up, and then disappeared from the top 20. And for example, also New York City. New York City was good, and then disappeared. And instead, a good story about Orsay, for example, in France, was, somehow good, jump, and stay there. And so, if you, for example, Rome disappeared, was not in the top 20 until 2005, and then now is actually up in the top 10. So you can imagine this map can be done for all the cities that we have. I'm showing you just the few of them. So another interesting thing is to look at the specific geographic information. So plot the rank in the map. And you see, for example, interesting thing that in US, there was a lot of blue. So the blue, the color is the higher the rank. And you see that in 1990s was mostly blue with some white spot. Instead, now you see that in the East Coast, we are actually losing a bit of ranks. And now we're going to go back to this point later. And you see, for example, here, Rome. I'm Italian, so let's speak about Italy for a while. So 43 in 1990s, now big jump to 9. And all this is Piscataway, that I didn't know before doing this job, actually disappeared nowadays. It's not anymore in the, actually it's in the top 10, but not it's not first. And Boston became first. And you see, again, Los Angeles and Berkeley dominating the ranking. You can actually do another thing, that is mapping this city level at the country level, then map country to continent and see what is the share of the top 100 as a function of time. For example, you see that in the 1990s, just 4% of the Asian city were in the top 100, and just 24% of the city in Europe were in the top 100, and the rest was just US. Nowadays, you see 11% for Asia, 33% for Europe, and 56%. So we see that actually there is also a delocalization, not just in terms of paper published in each account in US, but also on the ranks, on the quality of the paper. So, in conclusion, looking at the geographical information of this database and the database publication database in general is a very good thing to do. There is a lot to explore, and you can get a lot of information about socio-economical things, about countries, so it's very interesting. Using a network representation, again, is not a surprise for, I guess, this audience, helps a lot to map and cast what is the complexity of the system. And you can use, for example, a simple economical analogy in order to classify nodes in terms of production and consumption of science somehow. And then using, for example, the knowledge diffusion process, you can actually characterize how the knowledge diffuses, going beyond simple local measure. And then the scientific ranking algorithm can somehow objectively, more than maybe the H-index and others, rank the nodes. Of course, objectively is a big word. And this framework that I present just for the American Physical Society is general. You can apply to any type of citation network, if you please. So let me thank the collaborators, especially Kian, that did, she did, actually she here, and she did all the amazing visualization that I show you. And this is the paper, so citation, welcome. Thank you very much. Yeah, this is actually one possible factor, but we actually checked with other authors. They did actually a study for different fields, different journals, and the results are actually mostly the same. Of course, there are some variation, but it's a global trend, let's say. I mean, it's a very interesting question, and as far as I know, there is actually Filippo Radicchi that did something that is going that direction. You know, that you can comment on a paper, no? And you usually perceive something somehow bad, because somebody did a paper, you comment on it, say, no, this is not true, blah, blah, blah. But actually, the paper that get comments get more statistically more citation than others. So somehow, being disputed is something good for the authors. Of course, unless you do something very bad. That yeah, exactly. And also the affiliation, so it's very important. Yes. But I mean, yes, it's a good point. Yes.
Would you say that the world is becoming flat?
Yeah, actually, this has been observed, you know? Yeah. I think maybe it's possible. Before, the distance was, I mean, also the collaborative system now is much more easy, and now we can, you know. Yeah, I guess so, yeah. I think it's becoming more, you know, like delocalized, if you like, at least for what we observe. And actually, what we observe in many different fields, you know, from the PNAS papers by Katie Bourne and all these type of journals show these things, yes. Yes?
How complicated
was
it to do this at the paper level as opposed to the seed level?
No, paper level actually is much easier. Because the major cells are diffusion process, so they're based on like PageRank, so it runs very fastly, and you don't have actually to disentangle all the possible things to map in cities and level. The most annoying part of this work is actually to map papers to cities. If you don't have that problem, it's very easy and very fast. Thank you very much.